Good morning, students. Yesterday, I explained the whole of the thing regarding a legend of the Northland. So as I told you, like the legend of the Northland is a ballad. What is ballad? Ballad is a long poem with a story in it. Okay, it's a long poem with a story, in it. And it's just not about its length, it's just not about its story, but there are various other features of this poem that it becomes a ballad. This ballad happens to be a long tale, long story, with an explicit speaker and an explicit listener. Got it? So I'm telling you, like, how is this poem a ballad? What ballad is? So ballad is a long poem with a tale, right? And secondly, this long poem is, you know, it has an explicit speaker and an explicit listener. I'll be asking, while we going through the poem, I'll ask you, like, who do you think is a, where is that explicit speaker? Okay, in between I'll be asking you, where is that explicit listener? So it will be there, like one particular speaker and one particular listener happens to be there in the story. And moreover, this ballad happens to be well structured. Well structured. Structure, you know, form, the body of the poem is, you know, it is well formed. As you can see in this poem, each stanza is made up of four lines. And the four lines are called as quatrains. So each stanza made up of a quatrain, right? And each quatrain is well rhymed. So what I want to say, like, each stanza is well structured, and that each stanza of four lines, okay, doesn't mean that one stanza is of four lines and the other stanza is of five lines. No. So there is a proper pattern. Okay, structure is well formed. And next, each stanza of four lines has particular qualities of a poem, that is the rhyme scheme. Yesterday also I told you, like, the rhyme scheme of each stanza is A, B, C, B. Northland, last word of first stanza, Northland, A, a few, B, a winter, C, through. Through, few, they are matching, so B, B. A, B, C, B. That is the rhyme scheme of this first stanza, and it will be like this in the whole of the poem. Right? So what I'm saying, like, well, each stanza of four lines properly rhymed, and in each stanza there are some, number one, there are, it is rhymed, rhyme scheme is there, right? And then it is, you know, poetic devices are there. So it's many poetic devices. For example, the poem starts with like away, away, a sound. Number one, there is a repetition of the words away, away. And secondly, the another poetic device in the same two words is assonance, A-double-S. So poetic devices are there in abundance. Okay, this, the ballads happen to be the beautiful write-ups. Without poetic devices, you cannot term a poem as a great poem. So there will be many poetic devices in each stanza, just not one or two, sometimes more than that. There will be, you know, assonance, there will be simile, there would be metaphors, there would be personification. Apart from so many other, you know, poetic devices, it would be like full of poetic devices. So I was telling you the qualities of a ballad. Ballad has to be a long poem with a tale. So there is a story. It's a long story with a tale. Secondly, there has to be an explicit speaker and a listener. There will be And third, it is well structured with each stanza, which is rhymed, and there are proper poetic devices. And yes, there is a dramatic irony also in the story. There is a dramatic irony in the poem. A ballad is not a ballad if there is no irony. Okay, as I told you yesterday also, like the whole story is a dramatic narrative. The whole story has been told in a narrative. It's a narration. A story has been told. Okay, it happens to be a dramatic narrative also. That is also a feature of a ballad. It's a dramatic narrative. So dramatic narrative means the whole poem is, the whole story is narrated with a dramatic element in it. What is dramatic element? Dramatic element is when something, when the plot of the poem or of the story reaches the climax, and from there it comes down. So in the end, there is a solution. What is the climax? When the center of the plot, when the plot of the story reaches the highest level of anxiety or reaction. So at that time, when the story is at that highest point, the readers, the listeners, they all are, you know, very excited to know, like, what will happen next. And after that climax, the story has to come down. And we say, like, there should be a catharsis. That is, like, whatever the problem in the plot is, it should be solved. The problem should be sorted out, and that problem, the problem in the poem will be sorted out, and in the end, there will be a message. So ballad always usually has a message in the end. It's a dramatic narrative with an irony and with a message in the end. And the message of this poem is, number one, like, be virtuous. Don't be greedy. Okay? So have a large heart. Be magnanimous. Be generous. That's the main message of this poem. And selfishness will always land you in trouble. Okay? Selfishness, you'll have to pay for your selfishness. So don't be selfish. Okay? So a legend of the Northland. So here in this ballad, we are going to read about a story which belongs to, which has come from Northland. Yesterday I told you, like a legend is a, what's a legend? It's a tale it's an ancient tale. It's an old story which is told from generation to generation. And the legend may not be the reality. It might not, there is no fact, there is no proof that this legend was really there. There is no proof in the legend. Okay, so legend may not be true, but it goes on from generation to generation. And the purpose of the legends is to give a moral lesson to the coming generations. Got it? So here is a legend of the Northland. Northland is a place. And in the very first and second stanza, they are going to describe, like, what kind of place is Northland, right? So now let's start the poem. Away, away in the Northland, where the hours of the day are few, and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So now, like, very far away in Northland. The Northland is a place where the days are shorter and the nights are longer, especially in winter. So the nights are so long that people cannot sleep throughout the night. So Northland is what kind of geographical, where is that Northland? What's the main feature of this Northland? Like, here the days are shorter than the nights. Nights are so long that people cannot keep on sleeping throughout the night. They cannot sleep them through. So people cannot sleep throughout the night, right? Where the hours of the day are few. So the hours of the day are few means where the days are shorter and the nights are so long in winter, and the nights are longer than hours. Sorry, nights are longer than days. In which season? In the winter. So here in the very first line, away, away, this is a poetic device. Number one, repetition. The word away, away has been repeated. So what's the purpose of this repetition?
What is the purpose of this repetition of away, away?
The poet is emphasizing upon the fact like it was a far away place in Northland. It is not a place which is somewhere nearby. Okay, somewhere far away in Northland. So the story starts off with a dramatic tale kinds. Whenever your grandmother tells you a story, they start like a long time ago. The moment somebody says something like this, a long time ago, what happens? You feel anxious to know like what the story is going to be about. Okay, children often are drawn towards the stories which are which have the beginnings like very long ago, there lived a king. So the moment somebody listens to the words like long time ago or once upon a time, we people become, you know, focused. And this is a kind of, you know, the style of a narrative tale. And it starts off with a typical or with a very, very, you know, common way of telling a story. So very far away in Northland, where the days are shorter than nights, especially in winter. And the people cannot sleep throughout the night because the nights are very long. So away, away is number one, a repetition. And at the same time, away, away, in this away, away, when the poet says away, away, here a sound, it's a vowel sound. Here a sound is repeated. And when the vowel sound is repeated consecutively like this, we call the poetic device as assonance. So here the poet has used the poetic device called assonance. So where the that is the vowel sound is repeated. So the poem starts with the poetic device. So the ballads are rich in poetic devices. Okay. So, and in a ballad, there is always a particular place. So in this story, the setup is done in a place called Northland. So where they harness the swift reindeer, I'm on second stanza now. Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. And the children look like bears' cubs in their funny, furry clothes. Children, in the first stanza, did you notice that the third line and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So the third line does not have any full stop or comma or any semicolon or anything else. So the third line rolls onto the fourth line without any comma or without any punctuation mark. So we call it enjambment. Okay. Another poetic device in third line is, I'm going to rub it. I hope you might have noticed all this. You might have noted this. So here I'm talking about number one, I've told you like here is repetition, second is assonance. And the third poetic device in the first stanza itself is enjambment. What is enjambment? Here in this enjambment, the poet, the line rolls on to the next line without any punctuation mark. Third line rolls on to the fourth line without any full stop, comma or semicolon or colon, nothing is there. So we call it enjambment. Same is in the second stanza, the third line continues to the fourth line without any punctuation mark and we call it enjambment. So you will find enjambment almost in every stanza. So this is also a very prominent poetic device the poet is using in this ballad. Got it? So ballads are the ones where the poet has used rich poetic device, which are rich in poetic devices. So enjambment will be in almost all stanzas. You can note down the correct spellings. E-N-J-A-M-B-M-E-N-T, enjambments. Enjambment is a poetic device in which the line in a poem is rolled onto the next line without any punctuation mark, right? So where they harness the swift reindeer, so who is swift? Very fast. The one who runs very fast. What is reindeer? It's an animal, which is found only in cold regions like Northland or Antarctic and all. So where they harness the swift reindeer? What is harness? they make the reindeer run to the sledges. So here in this Northland, the winter is so severe that during the snow, when it snows, when it is very cold and when it starts snowing, they use the reindeer to harness. They harness the reindeer to the sledges. Sledges are the vehicles to which the reindeer is attached to help them in transportation. Okay, they go from one place to another on the sledges, which are run by reindeers. Got it? So this in this Northland, reindeers run the sledges. Who are they? They here are the people who live in Northland. Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges. Did you notice any particular sound which is coming up very prominently in this line? Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges. Which sound is coming very prominently? Anyone? I'm repeating. Try to make out like which sound is coming prominently through these words. Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges. When it snows and the children look like bears, cubs in their funny furry clothes. So is there any one particular sound coming up prominently? One particular sound which is coming prominently in the first and second line of second stanza is sir sound. Swift, sir, sledges, sir. And even then when it snows, sir. Okay, swift, snows and sledges. These three words are there with the sir sound coming prominently. Sir sound is written like this in phonetics. Okay, when I say swift, sledges, snows, then sir sound is coming up prominently. Right? So what we say when some one consonant, and what is sir, children? It's a consonant sound. When there is a repetition of a vowel sound, we call it assonance. And when there is a repetition of consonant sound, we call it, yes, you all know this, alliteration. So here the poetic device uses alliteration. You can note down the correct spellings. A double L I or A L L I T E R A T I O N, alliteration. So where is the alliteration? When the poet says, when they harness, even sir is there. When they harness the swift, sir in swift, reindeer to the sledges, sir, when it snows, sir. So sir comes up three times, we call it alliteration. Okay, you A-L-L-I-T-E-R-A-T-I-O-N. So alliteration is used in first and second line of stanza 2. So what is the meaning of this line? So when it starts snowing in the winter season, the people of Northland use reindeer to run the sledges when it snows. And the children look like bears, cubs in their funny furry clothes. So during this winter season, during this extreme winter season, the children are made to clad in many layers of dresses. Children, you know, get dressed up in layers. They put on many clothes. They put on many woolens to protect themselves against the cold season. And in those, you know, layers of dresses, they look like the bears, cubs, like bears, cubs. So they look like the cubs of bears. Okay, they look like the young ones of bear. So like bears, cubs, again a poetic device. What is it? What's the poetic device used in like bears, cubs? It is simile. So like bears, cubs, you can underline with you. Like bears, cub is a simile. S-I-M-I-L-E. So when the poet says like bears, cubs. So here the word like, if it had been as, even then it is a simile. S-I-M-I-L-E. Simile is a poetic device where the comparison is there with the help of as or like. Okay, when I say as soft as cotton. So here as soft as cotton is a simile. As white as snow, it's a simile. But if I say white, if I say black beauty, she's a black beauty. Okay, if I say she's as black as coal, that's a simile. But if I say she's a black beauty, it means that I'm calling her, I'm using metaphor. So simile is a comparison with as or like. So, and the children look like bears, cubs. So like bears, cub is a simile in their funny, furry clothes. Any poetic device in funny, furry clothes? You people will tell me now. Funny, furry clothes. Any poetic device here? You can raise hand and speak up. Come on. Why are you sitting? Yes, chat. So what is the poetic device in? Yes, funny and furry is alliteration. Well done. So funny, furry is again alliteration because here the fur sound, that is consonant sound, has been repeated. Here, fur sound. Okay. This fur sound is written like this. Fur sound has been repeated. And the children look like bears, cubs in their funny, furry clothes. So the poet is only describing basically that in the winter season, they use the reindeers. The reindeers run the sledges. And moreover, the children are dressed up in many layers to protect them from the winters. They tell them a curious story. Who are they? They are the people who live in Northland. So who are them? They tell them. Who are them? Them are the children. Okay, so the people of Northland tell their children a curious story. What is curious? A story with a keen plot, the story which makes them get inquisitive. So they tell them a story which has a very enthralling plot, which has a very captivating plot, which has a very interesting plot. Which they tell them a story. I don't believe this true. I, who is I? I told you that the ballad always has an explicit speaker. So this I is the explicit speaker. Okay. So explicit means clear. There is clearly one speaker, in the ballad. In this poem, you have got one speaker. I don't believe this. It's true. So the people of Northland tell the children a story which I don't think might be true. And yet, you will learn a lesson if I tell the tale to you. But if I tell you the story, then you will learn a lesson. So here the speaker says that I'm going to tell you a story. It might not be true. It is not true. He says he thinks so. But he's going to tell the story because the story has a moral. There is a lesson in the story. Got it? So again, the enjambment is there. Third line is rolled onto the fourth without any punctuation mark, right? So again, if you talk about alliteration, learn a lesson, l sound is there. Tell a tale, t sound is repeated, right? So this again, the alliteration you will find very prominently used by the poet. Okay? Once, when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below and walked about it preaching just as he did, you know. So who is once upon a time? The story starts off like this, like once upon a time when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below and walked about it preaching just as he did, you know. So once upon a time, there was a very good Saint Peter who lived in this world. And because Saint Peter was a saint, so he would just keep on walking about the world, and he would just keep on preaching the people. So as you always know, what do these saints do? Saints preach the people. And saints usually keep on traveling from one place to another. So because he was a saint, and children, when we talk about a legend, legends are, yesterday I told you, legends are always of famous people, okay? Famous people and the people who do something exemplary. Is that clear? Legends are about the famous people and the people who do something extraordinary. So whose legend is there? Here is a legend of Saint Peter. So Saint Peter is what kind of character? He is a saint. Here we have got a grand character in the form of Saint Peter. So once upon a time, there was a virtuous means the one who does good things. So once upon a time, there was a virtuous Saint Peter who walked about the world, thereby preaching the people always. Who walked about it. Walked about means Saint Peter just kept on traveling, kept on moving from one place to another to preach the people. He came to the door of a cottage in traveling round the earth. So Saint Peter, when he was traveling round the earth, when he was moving around the earth to preach the people, he was obviously he might have been tired, he might have been hungry, because he had been taking round of the world. So after having taken the round of the world, this Saint Peter might have been very tired, he was very hungry. So he came to the door of a cottage where a little woman was making cakes and baking them on the hearth. What is hearth? Hearth is a fireplace. What's a hearth? H-E-A-R-T-H, hearth is a fireplace. And hearth is rhyming with the word earth, earth, hearth. So that Saint Peter came to the door of a cottage. And in that cottage, a little woman was baking cakes. Got it? So he came to the door of a cottage in traveling around the earth. So when he was traveling all over the world, by chance, he happened to pass by the door by a cottage where a little woman lived. And at the time, she was baking cakes. And being faint with fasting, for the day was almost done, he asked her from her store of cakes to give him a single one. So, and being faint with fasting. What is faint? Faint means weak. Okay. Physically, he had become very weak because he had been observing fast. Because he had been fasting for the many days. Saints always, saints don't eat much. Saints, they don't do anything with which they satisfy their senses. So saints are usually on fast, right? But they eat only when they are very hungry. So he had become very weak because of the fasting. And moreover, the day was almost coming to an end. For the day was almost done means, and moreover, the day was almost coming to an end. And he asked that little woman to give him something out of the cakes which she had made. What did he ask her to give? He asked her to give him a single cake. What was the woman doing at that time? At that time, the little woman was baking cakes. And what did the man, what did Saint Peter ask her? He asked her only one single cake. Was it a very difficult thing? Was it something impossible for the woman to do? Did Saint Peter ask for something very difficult? Did he ask for something beyond limits? No. He asked her to give him what she had. And he asked her to give him just one piece, not many pieces. And so she made a very little cake. But as it baking lay, she looked at it and thought it seemed too large to give away. So she made a very little cake. Because he had asked her to give him a single cake, so she started baking a small cake. She started baking a very little cake. But when she was baking it, she looked at the cake and found that the cake was very large to be given. She found that the cake was too large to be given. Means she found that the cake was so large that she could not give it to him. Because the people, those who are miserly, the people, those who are miser, for them, small thing appears to be big things when they come to giving, right? Therefore, she needed another and still a smaller one. Therefore, she started kneading another dough and started making even a smaller cake. But it looked, when she turned it over, as large as the first one had done. So when she was turning it over, she found that the cake which she had made smaller from her side, even that cake appeared to be larger and of the same quantity. In quantity it appeared to be same as the first one was. What do you think? Was she making the was the size of the cake same as it was the first one? No, the size of the cake this time was definitely smaller, but because she had to give it to somebody, she found it still bigger. Then she took a tiny scrap of dough and rolled it flat and baked it thin as a wafer, but she couldn't part with that. Part with means to get separated. So finally, then she took a very small scrap of dough. She took very small amount of dough and she rolled it and almost flattened it. And the now that cake almost looked like a wafer. Wafer, you might be, you also might be eating wafers. They happen to be very thin. Cakes are not basically thin. But this time the cake which she rolled, it appeared to be like a wafer. But even then she did not want to give it to the saint. She found it still bigger. For she said, my cakes that seem too small when I eat of them myself. She said, like she told herself, like when I eat the cake, they appear to be very small and yet too large to give away. But when I start giving them, they appear to be very big. So she put them on the shelf. So she kept them aside because she did not want to give them to the saint. Okay, children, time is over. We'll continue the poem tomorrow from here. So today, whatever the poetic devices and all I have told you, note them down in your fair notebook. Is that clear? So, and tomorrow is Saturday. Today is Thursday. And this week on Saturday, your test will be of the chapter which we did last week and the poem which we are doing now. So whatever you people are doing side by side, it will be tested the same week. So whatever we have done this week or the this week, maybe tenses, maybe some other chapter, maybe this poem, whatever we did, that will be tested on Saturday. Is that clear?